हेलो, वेलकम टू सब्जेक्ट बेस्ड नेटवर्क बनारस हिंदू यूनिवर्सिटी. आई एम वैद्य विष्णु जोगळेकर एंड आई एम गोइंग टू गिव अ लेक्चर सीरीज ऑन द सब्जेक्ट पदार्थ विज्ञान, बट इट इज गोइंग टू बी फ्रॉम यूजर्स पर्स्पेक्टिव. सी, आई एम एक्स प्रोफेसर एंड एचओडी ऑफ अगद तंत्र फ्रॉम टिळक आयुर्वेद महाविद्यालय. आय हॅव टॉट अगदतंत्र, स्वस्थवृत्त, काय चिकित्सा, रोगनिदान, रिसर्च मेथडॉलॉजी, मेडिकल स्टॅटिस्टिक्स, व्हेरियस सब्जेक्ट्स ड्युरिंग माय करियर. सो आय एम अ यूजर ऑफ पदार्थ विज्ञान अँड आय एम गोइंग टू शेड लाईट ऑन various aspects of padartha vijnan from a user's perspective. The learning objective at the end of this lecture, you will be able to make an informed choice about whether to learn padartha vijnan or not. And in the second part of the lecture, I will be covering the process of acquisition of knowledge so that you should be able to describe that process. When I got admission to BAMS, it was a cultural shock for me. I have been trained in physics, chemistry, biology, maths, and I was typical example of a reductionist scientist. And suddenly I came across these words like dosha, pancha mahabhuta, agni, and I could not find any physical entity which resembles all these things. So it was a cultural shock for me. So to understand all these things, I tried to use my old tools of physics, chemistry, mathematics, molecular biology. These were old tools for me. Then I said, okay, let us use the new tools that I am learning in the college. These new tools were of Padartha Vijnan. Mind you, these tools are very old tools, but they were new for me. I had many questions. Fortunately, I had many gurus also. Advantage of living in Pune is that Pune has got at least 50 Vaidya families who are practicing Ayurveda in Pune for more than 400 years now, and all families are slightly different. They practice slightly differently, but all of them are very clear about one thing, that Padartha Vijnan is the foundation of Ayurveda and you cannot escape it. I had many discussions with them about chemical nature of doshas, whether vata is nitrous oxide, whether pitta is ATP, pitta is enzymes, what is the chemical nature, because that was the key question of contention. When all these families said that doshas are material, then I started to inquire about the physical nature, the molecular nature of the things. Then I came across the second school of thought, which was more near to me, that these are forms of energy. When I was learning or reading about chaos theory or complexity theory, I came across a concept called as strange attractors. These strange attractors are at the borderline between disorder and order. Which kind of order is created depends upon the nature of these strange attractors. And with this, I first got my insight about Tridosha theory. I propose a theory of strange attractors where Vata controls movement and signaling, Pitta controls transformation, and Kapha controls assimilation. Another theory which was completely unimaginable to me or completely incomprehensible to me was the Triguna theory, Sattva, Raja and Tama. Right from childhood I had learned in Gita about Sattva, Raja and Tama, Sattvic Ahar, Tamas Ahar, Rajas Ahar, etc. etc. But I couldn't understand these three concepts, Sattva, Raja and Tama, how material things come out of Sattvic, Rajas and Tamas Ahankar according to Sankhya philosophy. I couldn't understand at all. Then one day I heard a lecture from Dr. Milind Vatave. He is an evolutionary medicine expert. He has published a book called Doves, Diplomats and Diabetes. After the lecture, I started to discuss with him. His basic theory about diabetes is something like this. Aggression is a powerful evolutionary strategy. It is useful to gain access to more and more resources. So many people or organisms develop a strategy of aggression. But if everybody is aggressive, then nobody gets the resources. So some people have devised a different strategy, and that is of diplomacy. They try to avoid conflicts. They try to cool down the temperatures in any conflict. And for that they need to be cool. And to keep their cool, their brain requires tremendous amount of sugar. So these diplomats developed a strategy which was incorporated in their genes, that they will provide more and more sugar to their brains. And this was a good strategy which was useful in many of the situations. But what happened after industrialization is direct conflict everywhere came down sharply. Conflict was there, no doubt, but the level of conflict came down very sharply. Of course, there are flares like various wars, but industrialized society led to a situation where that kind of blood sugar was not required. But the genes were already there. So, instead of being useful, those genes produced diabetes. That was his gist of his theory. And suddenly, I remembered the words alternate words used for sattva, raja and tama, and those words are kalyanausha, roshausha and mohausha. And now I visualize the sattva, raja, tama theory, that sattva, raja and tama are engines of evolution. So from the cultural shock to coming to understand sattva, raja, tama as engines of evolution was my journey in this whole career. Evolution of Ayurveda is something which many Vaidyas don't believe. They believe that Ayurveda came into existence when Brahma remembered the Ayurveda. It is anadi ananta and there cannot be any evolution of Ayurveda. But as we go through various texts, classical texts of Ayurveda, we realize that Ayurveda is a Sarva Darshan Parishad, and Ayurveda has taken many things from many philosophical streams, including Charvaka. We have taken theory of evolution from Sankhya. We have taken multidimensionality from Jain philosophy. From Purva Mimamsa, we have taken interpretation techniques. From Vedanta Darshan, we have taken the concept of Chikitsa Purusha. From Bauddha Darshan, we have taken the Kshanabhanguravad, or temporary nature or dynamic nature of things. From Vaisheshika Darshan, we have taken many concepts about matters and methods to handle that matter. From Nyaya Darshan, we have taken the methods of assessment. And this has taken place even before Charaka or Sushruta or Vagbhata. But recently, new evolution is taking place and we are coming across many new sciences which we can incorporate in Ayurveda if we know our Padartha Vidnyan. So that is a prerequisite for integration of modern sciences in Ayurveda. Various sciences like biophysics, engineering, social sciences, epidemiology, molecular biology, life sciences, infotech, biotech, many sciences are there and they can be integrated into Ayurveda if we learn our Padartha Vidnyan very well. As I said earlier, the Sankhya philosophy of Srushti Utpatti is very, very similar to the theory, Big Bang theory in quantum mechanics. In Sankhya theory, the Purusha observes Prakriti. Purusha is Sakshi and Prakriti is there. Prakriti and Purusha are anadi and ananta. So whenever Purusha observes Prakriti, there is perturbation in Prakriti which leads to generation of tanmatra, ahankar, mahat, etc., etc. And what quantum mechanics says? It will be described in much greater detail in the next lecture, but here I will say only one thing, that there is something called as Dirac equation, and this Dirac equation is for collapse of wave function, and the basic premise is unless and until somebody, some observer observes, there is no fixed state of anything, matter or energy. That takes place only when observer observes. So both the things, Prakriti and Purush, and observer observes the things, are extremely similar. So we can find many similarities in this. Ayurveda is Sarvadarshana Sangraha or Sarvadarshana Parishad, and we have taken many things from many philosophies, and we can add to them many more things. From Sankhya Darshana, we have taken Srushti Utpatti theory, which is very similar to quantum physics, but Sankhya Darshana also is very similar to big data analysis. The Vaisheshik Darshan is parallel to informatics. From Nyaya Darshana, we can have a similarity to analytics. From Yoga Darshana, we can take a parallelism from harmonics and ethics. Such parallels from Mimamsa Darshana can be with management and cosmology. From Jaina Darshan, we have taken the theory of complexity, the chaos theory. It's very parallel to Jain Darshan. We have also taken many things like public health from Charvaka Darshana. In our next lecture, we are going to deal with all these darshanas in a different manner. I am reminded of Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 2013. Previously, when scientists wanted to simulate molecules on computers, they had various softwares at their disposal. But these softwares couldn't handle all the spectrum of chemical reactions. If scientists wanted to know about minute changes happening in molecules, the angle between two atoms, like that, they had to use softwares which were based on quantum physics. But if they wanted to know about what is happening in a big drum of chemical, then they had to use different softwares which were based on classical Newtonian physics. In 2013, Nobel Prize of Chemistry was awarded to Martin Karplus, Michael Levitt and Aria Warshall, who were able to combine both kinds of softwares, classical physics as well as quantum physics, into one single software. If this is the case, two different philosophies put together in a single package can win a Nobel Prize. I think Ayurveda should get some hundreds of Nobel Prizes for just being a Sarvadarshana Parishad. Everybody doesn't need to be a master, but everybody needs something basic, just like mathematics. In mathematics, everybody needs the basic tools, addition, subtraction, multiplication and division. But there are many advanced tools like calculus, trigonometry, topography, absurds and fractions and many more things, set theory. Not everybody needs to understand all these advanced methods. He has to understand addition, subtraction, multiplication and division. But that doesn't mean that advanced techniques are useless. Every appliance that we use in our household involves the use of these advanced techniques. Only thing is, we don't need them for day-to-day life. The same thing is true about Padartha Vijnan. It is essential to learn Padartha Vijnan for anything in Ayurveda. But for day-to-day use, only some basic things are needed. Advanced things are needed for research and development. For Ayurveda or Padartha Vijnan, the basics are thorough knowledge of Pratyaksha, Anuman and Yukti Praman with fourth option of Shabda Praman. I have kept Shabda Praman as optional here. It is following Charaka. But most of the Ayurvedic people forget about Pratyaksha, Anuman and Yukti and rely solely on Shabda Praman, and that leads to some conflicts. So I say that you master Pratyaksha, Anuman and Yukti and have some good understanding about Shabda, but Shabda is optional. You can get the meaning of everything which is said in Ayurveda. But for deeper study, we will need many more things. We can have many more tools like Uddesh, Hetvabha, Hetvartha, Hetvantar, Tantra Yukti, Adhikaran, Arthapatti, Karan, Jnana Hetu, Karyaphala, Karyayoni, Karyaguru, Laghava, Upalambha, many more things if we go deep enough. And that is like learning calculus, trigonometry, etc. for mathematics. Then you will ask, what is the use of Padartha Vijnan for me? So if you are a college student in first year, you need to learn Padartha Vijnan to pass the examination. That is the obvious reason. For second year, Padartha Vijnan is very useful to understand and read classical texts. And another thing is, it is also very useful for preparation of oral examinations, vaivaha bhos. You see, in Ayurveda, there is, in Padartha Vijnan also, there is a chapter on Tadvidya Sambhasha or Vada Paribhasha. And the tools in Vada Paribhasha are very useful in preparation for vaiva. Many a times we think that our examiner already knows many things, so we skip many steps and the examiner is waiting to hear your own understanding of the subject. So what I advise my students is something like this. You are in the field of Ayurveda, but you have many colleagues who are in different fields, say commerce or engineering, and try to answer every question in a vaiva bhos as if you are explaining the concept or thing to your classmate from 12th who is now doing accounting or law or mathematics or whatever other stream of knowledge, and that will give you very good marks in your viva. In the third year, you can extend the use of Padartha Vinyan to Tika Vachana, but more important is use of Padartha Vinyan for Rugna Parikshana. See, as you learn Padartha Vinyan thoroughly, your antennas are very sensitive. They become very sensitive. So whenever patient is telling you anything, you are alert about what is normal and what is not normal, what is expected and what is unexpected, and that gives you a clue about condition of patients. So learning Padartha Vidyan is useful for Rugna Parikshan also. Many people don't find this relation easy to understand, but believe me, there is definitely this relation. Nowadays, in fourth year, there is a subject called research methodology and medical statistics. And research methodology is nothing but Padartha Vinyan told in different terms. So if you understand Padartha Vinyan, you will be easily able to understand research methodology. If you take admission to MD, then in the first year, research methodology is a subject to you. You have to extend your knowledge of research methodology to a greater extent. Another thing is, you have to find out a research question for your dissertation. And if you are familiar with Padartha Vinyan, if you have internalized it, you will find a very good research question. You will be able to frame your question in such a manner that it translates into a research project. For MD second year and third year, you can use Padartha Vinyan as a tool for literature research, because when you Google something, you get millions of references. Or if you go to PubMed and search, you will get thousands of papers. You have to be able to narrow down your research, apply various filters to get your literature search to a manageable proportion. You can use various softwares, no doubt about that. But if you understand Padartha Vidyan, this will be very easy. It is also useful for writing your dissertation, thesis or paper. Now, practitioners will say, what is the use of Padartha Vidyan for me in practice? As I already said, it is useful for for Rugna Parikshan, and it is also an ability to do the Nirakshira Vivek. What is true and what is false? The differentiation you can do much better if you have internalized Padartha Vidyan. I agree that not everything in Padartha Vidyan is useful to everybody. Let us say only 50% is useful. But nobody knows beforehand which 50% we are not going to need. So that's why we have to learn the whole. In modern management, when we undertake any new endeavor, management experts tell us to do SWOT analysis: strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. In fact, Charak Samhita also tells us the same thing. Charak Samhita does not simply finish with only four things. Charak Samhita says, for every task to be done, first thing is you have to establish the priority of that, and depending upon the priority, you will have to find out the plan of work, which will involve 10 things. Karya, karana, karta, karma, karya phala, anubandha, many things are there. Total 10 things are there. The karya guru laghava we have already seen. Next four things we are going to learn about. The strengths of Padartha Vijnan is, it gives you clarity of concepts. It gives you ability to detect false information or false reasoning, and it is useful in every aspect of Ayurveda, namely Shastra, Tattva and Vyavahar. Weaknesses, Padartha Vijnan may not be useful for everyday requirements. We don't know which 50%, and there will be always a confusion. Also, Padartha Vijnan, many terms are used in a different context than what we use in our day-to-day language or even the language of Ayurvedic classics. Simple example is, Charak terms pramana as pariksha. The word pramana as used in Charaka is entirely different from what is used in Padartha Vijnan. So it can be very confusing. Opportunities by learning Padartha Vijnan, it is a treasure hunt. You can find many intricate interpretations of Ayurveda if you use Padartha Vijnan wisely. You will be able to think better, and thinking better will lead to better writing. Padartha Vijnan is like a master key. If you go to any hotel, there is a different key for every room. But hotel management has a master key which can open any room. And Padartha Vijnan is the master key which can open any topic in Ayurveda. Obviously, there are some threats. First threat is abhinivesh. You are so enamored with your own concepts that you cannot tolerate any kind of dispute. That happens with people who emphasize on Padartha Vijnan to the exclusion of all other practical things. Second thing which I call is correctile dysfunction. You are very prone to correct everything what your opponent or what your colleague or what your family member says. You have a compulsion to correct everything which other party is saying. It becomes an obsession and it prevents you from furthering your career. You cannot become a team player if you are having a correctile dysfunction. So what are the learning objectives of Padartha Vijnan as a whole? I will divide the learning objectives into attitude objectives, skills objectives and knowledge objectives. Attitude objectives are, you want to know why. Skills, you know how to do anything. And knowledge is to know what. And if these three things come together, you get the abilities. So for Padartha Vijnan, I have divided these learning objectives into Pramana Vichar and Prameya Vichar. Knowledge objectives is to have adequate information about each Pramana, so we are able to understand and internalize the use of Pramana. For Prameya Vichar, it is knowing the varieties and details of Sapta Padartha and understanding and internalization of this knowledge. The skills objectives for Pramana Vichar are proficiency in application of Pramana and ability to analyze the information. There are four steps in learning any sutra in Ayurveda. The first two steps are Padachheda and Padarthokti. Those require Vyakaran. But the next two steps, Akshepa and Samadhan, will require thorough understanding and internalization of Pramana Vichar. And that is the skills objective of this series. The attitude objectives are equally important. We have to assume everything as incorrect until proven by Pramanas. I have taught Agada Tantra for many years. So for autopsy, I begin with the saying that approach every case for postmortem as if it is a murder, unless proved otherwise. In learning Ayurveda, we should also assume that everything is incorrect until proven by Pramanas. And getting a single proof is not enough. We should not be satisfied with a single proof. We should always keep seeking supportive evidence. In Prameya Vichar, this attitude objective is selection of appropriate pramana for appropriate situation. In the Dashavidha Pariksha Bhava, we have already covered five of them. The remaining five are Anubandha. Anubandha of learning Padartha Vijnan will be stability of intellect. The Desha of this endeavor will be e-learning mode. The Kala, as I visualize it, will be around 50 e-lectures. Pravrutti in this endeavor will be problem-based learning or PBL. And Upaya or prerequisite for this endeavor is blank slate. You must unlearn what you have learned. And after that, we should be able to gain knowledge. In the second part of this lecture, we are going to review the process of knowledge briefly. There is something. Somebody observes it. And when this process of observation takes place, something which is, and the observer gain a specific designation. The observer is Sakshi or witness, and the thing which he observes, he or she observes, becomes Prameya or object of interest. Now this transformation gives rise to something called Jidnyasa or curiosity. Sakshi becomes curious about the nature of Prameya or object of interest. When this happens, he will use some tools. These tools are called as pramana, knowledge tools. After using these tools on prameya, there is a change and sakshi becomes pramata or knower, and there is origin of prama or true knowledge about object of interest. Of course, there can be false knowledge also, which is called as bhranti. The whole process is quite complicated, as seen in this slide. It's very complicated thing. There are many things to internalize before we can transform ourselves from sakshi to pramata, or witness to the knower. We'll look at this process in detail. The first thing which happens is sakshi or witness uses pramana or knowledge tool on prameya, the object of interest. Now this will result into something called as ikshana or observation. It is not enough just to get an observation. What we need is the next step, which is called as anvikshana or analysis of the observation. Now this anvikshana or analysis may result into various things. There are different outcomes of anvikshana. So there are different outcomes of anvikshana or analysis, which lead to two different things. One is bhranti or false knowledge, and when bhranti vanishes, there is prama, and sakshi is converted into pramata, witness to knower, and that process goes through anvikshana or analysis. One of the outcome of anvikshana is saushaya. What happens in saushaya? We find that observation is inconclusive. We cannot be very sure about whatever we are thinking about prameya. So this condition is called as saushaya. What we do in case of saushaya? We use another pramana or another knowledge tool until we get to either bhranti, and when bhranti vanishes, it will be conversion of sakshi to pramata, generation of true knowledge. And we repeat this process in case of saushaya until there is prama and sakshi becomes pramata. Another outcome of anvikshana or analysis is called as viparyaya. Whatever we thought beforehand is proved to be incorrect. Exactly the opposite thing is found to be correct. So this is called as viparyaya. Again, viparyaya can result in bhranti, and when bhranti vanishes, then sakshi becomes pramata and prama or true knowledge is generated. The third outcome of anvikshana can be tarka. Means we are partially aware of properties of prameya, but we don't know it in complete manner. So in that case, the outcome of analysis is tarka. We speculate about what is happening in prameya, or what are the properties of prameya. So what action do we take when the outcome of anvikshana is tarka? Here we use something called as yukti. This yukti can also be taken as experimentation. Most of the modern science uses this yukti or experimentation to gain knowledge about prameya. So what we do in experimentation is we manipulate the prameya in predetermined manner and then find out what are the changes in ikshana or observation. And step by step we get to know about prameya. We know what changes in prameya will cause what changes in observation, and that will lead to either bhranti, and when bhranti vanishes, again prama is generated, true knowledge is generated, and sakshi becomes the pramata. Thank you very much for patient listening.